debate feminism, religion, and atheism. In particular, we want to find out whether Christianity harms women and whether there's a problem for women in the new atheism movement. We have two speakers here. They are Karen Garst and Bernie Daler. Karen L. Garst holds a PhD from the University of Wisconsin. In 2008, she retired after 13 years as executive director of the Oregon State Bar. In response to the US Supreme Court's decision in Burwell versus Hobby Lobby, which ruled in 2014 that the company could refuse to offer certain forms of contraception to its employees that they were required to under the Affordable Care Act because of their religious views, she began a project to write a book about women who tell their stories of leaving religion. She states that religion, because of its subordination of women, is the last cultural barrier to gender equality. The book will be released in the fall of 2016 by Pitchstone Publishing. The working title is Women Beyond Belief. She also has a website at faithlessfeminist.com and a Facebook page and a YouTube channel under the name Faithless Feminist. Karen, you want to add anything?
No,
it's fine. Good. And Bernie has a bachelor's degree in electronics engineering technology and a master's in ministry degree. He's been working in the computer industry since 1984. After 25 years as a born-again evangelical Christian, he became an atheist in 2009. He participates in many Christian atheist debates, which can be found on his YouTube channel, which I think is called Secumer.
Secumer, yeah, short for Secular Humanism, S-E-C-H-U-M-M-E-R.
He's the author of a booklet called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology. He is also involved in local humanist groups and is a certified humanist celebrant. On a monthly basis, he visits the humanist group in the Sheridan Federal Prison to give them support. So we'll start with two 10-minute presentations. I think first is Karen.
Yes, I again apologize for my voice. Thank you for being here. I'm going to take the position that Christianity harms women, and then I'm going to discuss women in the new atheism movement. I will only use the slides for the pictures that are on the PowerPoint, as I know it's difficult to see. Pearl Buck once said, if you want to understand today, you have to search yesterday. I think it's really important to go back and look at what happened long before Christianity, that set the stage for Christianity, and particularly in regard to women and how did that influence it. I'm going to discuss five issues: the elimination of the feminine divine, the association of lust and sin with women, examples of atrocities that have been specifically targeted at women, the legacy of patriarchy today in the United States, and religious attacks on women's rights. Now, in this short of a debate, I don't have time to go back to the Paleolithic. So I'm only going back to, this is a figurine of a mother goddess. It's believed to be the grain goddess. It was found in Catalhoyuk in 6000 BCE. And as you can see, she's sitting on a throne. There are lions next to her that indicate a stature. She may even have a little crown on her head. At this time, and certainly before that, there were females that were worshipped, if you want to say that way, that held the position of some kind of feminine divine. And then what happened, the Indo-European tribes came down into the Mediterranean subsequent to this, and they had sky gods, male gods, associated with lightning, thunderbolts. And you'll see that even in the Old Testament, you'll see the portrayal of being on a mountain, thunder and lightning. Well, this is very similar. When they came down, these gods associated with the goddesses usually took them on as a consort. And in this next slide, you'll see a Sumerian seal from 2500 BCE, where you have a male god and a female goddess. And what's interesting in this slide, you will see things that we'll talk about later on, the tree that'll appear in the Garden of Eden, the snake that's associated with the goddess, but they coexisted. Then what happened later on, and perhaps occurred first in Babylonia, was the male wanted ascendancy. So Marduk said to the other male gods, hey, look, you give me supreme position, and I'll get rid of Tiamat. I'll get rid of the female, and it'll just be us guys. And it's interesting that he kills Tiamat. He splits the ocean, and in the myth called Enuma Elish, which is a Babylonian myth, that creates heaven and earth. And this same theme you find in the Old Testament with Leviathan, the sea dragon, etc. And as we know, the Israelites spent their exile in Babylon, where they certainly heard about this myth. But this wasn't just going on in Babylon. This was happening all over the Mediterranean, where the male god took ascendancy. And in the three monotheistic traditions, the feminine divine is completely eliminated. Then we have the association of sex and sin with women. We have the Garden of Eden. We have those symbols of the goddess, the snake, the tree, and the woman is accused of taking the first bite. Tertullian, who was a church leader in the 3rd century, said, and do you not know that you are Eve? God's sentence hangs still over all your sex, and his punishment weighs down upon you. You were the devil's gateway. You were she who first violated the forbidden tree and broke the law of God. So we see early on, as Christianity getting established, that women are seen to be lesser than men. They're the cause of original sin as it gets developed in Tertullian and St. Augustine, etc. And this is a tradition that continues on. And today in the Catholic Church, women are priests. So this develops, culture develops over time. And Thomas Aquinas, let's jump ahead 10 centuries, says, as regards the individual nature, woman is defective and misgotten, for the active force in the male seed tends to the production of a perfect likeness in the masculine sex, while the production of woman comes from a defect in the active force, or from some material indisposition, or even from some external influence. And lest you think this is history and it really doesn't matter, it's gone, it's not happening today, Pastor Ashley Ray of the Ridgeway Baptist Church in Tennessee said, and that's a man, that saying that the man was to lead, when the lady led, the human race fell. So this still continues today. I wanted to mention some specific atrocities targeted at women throughout Christianity. One of the first one is called Malleus Maleficarum. It's this hammer of witches that occurred in the 15th century. Two monks basically wrote a paper, gave it to the church adopted it, and it was a license to kill witches. It just so happens at the same time that men were trying to enter the medical profession, and the women were the midwives, the women were the healers. Well, what better way to get rid of the competition than have them declared witches? There were two villages after a trial in 1585 in Germany that were only left with a single female inhabitant. Hundreds of thousands of people were killed, primarily women. A quote from that time, no one does more harm to the Catholic faith than midwives. For when they do not kill children, then, as if for some other purpose, they take them out of the room and, raising them up in the air, offer them to devils. In 2020, bringing us to the present, a few short years ago, only 27 states allowed certified professional midwives to practice legally. So our culture stays with us a very long time. Second, in 1975 in Ireland, they discovered a sewer pipe that had 800 skeletons of children. This was from they call them Magdalene laundries. This was the Sisters of Bon Secours, which in French means we're here to help, who took pregnant girls, prostitutes, even virgin girls, put them away, exploited them as slaves, didn't treat the children well, and most of these children died of malnutrition or TB. 800. That was in only one of those facilities. And of course, this was run by Catholic nuns. And then finally, to bring it up to today, we have the slaughter at the Colorado Springs Planned Parenthood. The legacy of patriarchy, which everyone will agree is in most cultures, it wasn't until 1900 that the woman could own property in the United States. it's kind of hard to catch up with the robber barons when you don't get to come in until 1900. There's a lingering wage disparity. 80% of Congress is male, 95% of CEOs in Fortune 500 companies are men. So we do have a way to go. We're making a lot of progress. Religious attacks on women's rights. The Catholic Church prohibits birth control. The United States Supreme Court and Hobby Lobby. Efforts to eliminate safe and legal abortion. And the states that are now defunding Planned Parenthood, which is basic health care for women. So I think, yes, Christianity harms women. It has in the past, and it continues to do so. New Atheism's impact on women. I think we have all heard of the Four Horsemen, which comes from Revelation. Richard Dawkins, Samuel Harris, Daniel Dennett, Christopher Hitchens, unfortunately, has passed away. Their focus was on science and philosophy, and they talked about why there isn't a God, and they dealt with all those philosophical questions like the ontological question and all of those. Unfortunately, there have been a lot of women who've engaged in the type of outspoken behavior that these men have. There are a lot of women in the atheist movement. The majority are still men. But if you go to YouTube and look for debates, you will not find very many women. And when I heard what happened in Hobby Lobby, I decided I need to take a position. I need to stand up. And so does everyone else who's a woman who's an atheist. It's up to us to have our voices heard. We can't expect somebody else to help us get our voices heard. We need to do that ourselves. And I've reached out to a number of very well-known women atheists, say, you need to get on the debate. You have the background. You need to do it. And I do not get much response from them. So I blame us for that. But it is changing. I also think we need to focus on culture in addition to science and philosophy. What is it that keeps women in the churches? My 94-year-old mother-in-law is still head of a team in her Catholic parish to put on funerals. Growing up, her husband stayed at home, my husband's father. She was the one who took the kids to church. She was the one who did this. And I think if you were raised in a religious tradition, you knew who does the work in churches. What is it that holds them there? And I think that's something we need to explore. Thank you very much.
Very nice. Okay, now we will have a 10-minute presentation from Bernie.
Okay, did you mention what the format's going to be also, as far as the interchanging?
So after this, we'll have 10 minutes for each speaker to interrogate, in the nice sense of the word, the other speaker. And then after that, we'll have around 40 minutes for audience questions and answers.
That's not going to be nearly enough.
And we'll have plenty of good discussion time. And then to wrap things up, we'll have closing remarks from each speaker. Then we'll all go home.
And for you in the back, I don't know if you know or not, but there's a screen here. We didn't have a projector, so if you want to see, you can move up closer if you want to see the screen too. So. Okay. This is actually a picture of a protest here outside of a Hooters. I think it's in San Francisco. The woman's holding a sign, women are not decorations. I'm gonna come back to this. But you know what, in our society, there's a dialogue about what is appropriate attire and behavior for women. So that's one thing I'm gonna address also. So let me start with, since we're talking about feminism here, what is the F word? What is feminism? And so here's a real easy definition I'm going to give. It's the advocacy of women's rights on the grounds of political, social, and economic equality to men. So in other words, treating women like men. And as far as I'm concerned, if you think that women should be treated like men, then you're a feminist. You could be a guy feminist, you could be a woman feminist, it doesn't matter. As long as you believe in equal rights, you're a feminist. That's what it means. So. If somebody says, I believe in equal rights, but I'm not a feminist, I would have an issue with them. I would say maybe they don't understand what the word is. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that also. So for example, here's a question just to think about the word a little bit. I think it's a fact that women seem to be underrepresented in math and physics. They're not underrepresented in everything. For example, from what I understand, for veterinarians, it's heavily dominated by women. So there are some fields, and even I think there's more women in college than men. Some fields, there's plenty of women. But in math and physics, there seems to be an underrepresentation. So maybe there's two possibilities. Maybe women are culturally dissuaded from going into math and physics, or could it be that women naturally aren't as interested in math and physics? Which one of those sides would be a feminist viewpoint? Well, I think the answer is neither one, actually. I think this is it's something that feminists can debate, and actually there is a good debate on YouTube. One of my role models is Steven Pinker. I think he's one of the most brilliant guys alive. He's like the Einstein of philosophy and just about everything, I think. I learned a lot from him. And he debated this woman named Elizabeth Spelke, and they talked about this very thing, and they're both feminists. So this is something where somebody could take a side and say, well, I'm a feminist and I believe this, but that doesn't mean they're speaking for all feminists. So what I want to introduce to you is that you can be a feminist and disagree with other feminists. There's like factions in feminism, just like there's factions in Christianity and atheism or anything. You have the extreme sides and you have things that people can argue about. Here's another example. Look at these bathing suits. They're for women. I mean, one woman might say, like, oh, women should not dress so scantily like that. They should wear a one piece. And then here's a picture of, just to be equal, here's a guy. It has what they call a banana sling, I think, or something. He's basically nude almost. And somebody else has board shorts. So what's the correct feminist position? I think feminism is about equal rights. These guys have the right to wear what they want to wear. So I don't think this is a feminist issue. I think it's a social issue. So I don't think you should say there's a feminist position on this. Here's another one. I'm trying to show two extremes and a center point. Again, with women attire, what could they wear? On the right hand, there's a woman wearing body paint. She's basically nude. She might be able to go out in public like that. She may get away with that. I don't know if she would get a ticket for that. Because in a way, she's kind of covered up. On the other side, we have women wearing bags. They're basically the burqa. And then in between has like a dress that would be perfectly acceptable, like a 50s kind of look. So I think the woman on the right wearing the body paint, she's got equal rights. She could probably get away with that. I think that's a social issue. I don't think that's a feminist issue whether she should be able to do that in public or not. The ones in the burqa, though, this might be something that's interesting to debate, because some women might say, hey, they're making a choice. They want to wear that. They should be allowed to do that. And there may be a counterpoint saying, well, they're prisoners of their religion. They don't understand that, it's like a Stockholm syndrome. They don't realize their minds have been captive. They don't know what it's like to be equal. They should be liberated from this. The burqa should be illegal. So, I could see how people would debate that. Personally, I would go on the side where I think they should be liberated. They should be told there's a different way, but you got to realize you're talking to a brainwashed person, a person who's saturated in this system where it's normal to them. So, you just can't go in there and say, it's difficult to go into another country and say your whole system is crazy, So this is part of the clash of the civilizations, I guess, with the Muslims, because they have a whole totally different way of living. So the first question was, we have two questions, and the first question was, does Christianity harm women? I would say yes and no. I would say yes, most denominations do have harmful ideas about women, but I would say no, not all denominations. So I think me and Karen would have a disagreement here. I think she's saying all Christianity is harmful for women, and I would say no, I don't think so. So here's some more details on that. If you, for example, one way most Christianity has a problem with women is this, especially if you're a Protestant. I mean, women are forbidden from leadership in a lot of positions. They can't be the head of their church. And if you look at the Catholic Church, for example, I'll just go to the next slide. The Catholic Church, for example, in America is 21%. I believe in America, it's 21% of all Christians are Catholic, and so by far it's the largest denomination. And in this denomination, you have a pope, and there's no way you're going to have a woman pope. according to their current system. And then they have their priests and their nuns, and a woman cannot ever be a priest. So, and I think the priests have, they're higher up in influence and prestige than a nun, for example, too. So that's an obvious example of problems with women equality in the largest denomination. And then I've been to Baptist churches where, of course, like I said, you can't have women leaders. But I think it's important to recognize how people self-identify, and if somebody says they're a Christian, we have to appreciate that. When I was a Christian, in my final state as a Christian, I didn't have any problem with women. I thought it was perfectly fine for women to be in leadership. So in my brand of Christianity, there was no problem with feminism. I would totally support a woman for any position, total equal rights. So that's my disagreement with Karen. I would say not all Christians today. Here's a passage. You know, actually, people argue you can use the Bible to prove either way. I mean, for example, in 1 Timothy, it says, I do not permit a woman to teach or to assume authority over a man. She must be quiet. But if you go to the website for the Foursquare Church, a church that was started by a woman, Amy Semple McPherson, you go to their website, and it says, empowering leadership culture. It says, according to God's gifting and calling, we will intentionally prepare and release men and women across generations and cultures into all positions of leadership and areas of ministry. So as far as I used to attend a Foursquare church too. As far as I know, they have absolutely no issues with women in any kind of leadership position. And it makes sense because their whole church denomination is started by a woman, so how could they have a limitation on it? So now I'm gonna talk a little bit about the new atheism movement. There's two cases, and Karen didn't bring up either one of them, but one of them is called Elevator Gate, and this is where a woman activist, basically at a conference, it was 4 a.m, she's going back to her hotel room, and a guy said, hey, I really like what you said. Would you like to come to my room and we can talk about it some more over some coffee? And she basically said, guys, don't do that, that's a bad thing. And then Richard Dawkins, who's the most famous atheist, said basically, because Rebecca Watson was kind of sounding like, you know, this is some kind of, I don't know, some feminist issue or something. And Richard Dawkins was saying, oh, you know, poor you, you know, like there's women suffering in all these other cultures, you know, and they're Islam, but, you know, poor little you got invited to coffee at 4 a.m. in an elevator. I feel sorry for you, you know. So some people said, you know, Richard Dawkins is really bad, and that's a, you know, misogynist, woman-hating kind of attitude. So that's one issue, and I don't think that's a feminist issue. I think that's just a social etiquette issue. The other one is Michael Shermer is a very famous atheist, and he was accused of date raping a woman, and that was all about gossip, I think. There was nothing there. So I'm out of time, but I do have a slide here about all the great things that feminism has brought us. So I just want to say, in summary, I think Christianity does have some built-in problems with feminism, thanks to the Bible. But in atheism, the new atheism movement, I would say there's no problems whatsoever. So that's contrary to Karen's position. She thinks there's a problem in the new atheism movement, and I say there's no problem whatsoever. So.
Okay, thanks, Bernie. Karen, you will now have 10 minutes to interrogate Bernie.
I probably won't use 10 minutes. I'd much rather hear your questions. Bernie, you stated that in your brand of Christianity, you didn't think there was a problem with women. What was the book that was considered sacred in your brand of Christianity?
Sacred? I mean, the Bible.
The Bible?
Sure.
Oh, okay. So, are you familiar with the story of Jephthah's daughter?
Yes.
And
yes.
What happens there?
Yeah, it's very sad. He basically said, if I get victory in this battle, I'll sacrifice the first thing I see, and it was his daughter who he really loved, and according to the story, he had to sacrifice her because he made a vow to God. It's a pretty lame story. I mean, as a Christian, I didn't like that story at all.
Yeah, and who did not intervene to save the virgin daughter? Well, let's back up a little. In the story of the sacrifice of Isaac, Abraham is ready to sacrifice his son. Who intervenes to avoid that child being sacrificed?
God does.
God. Does God intervene in saving Jephthah's virgin daughter?
Mm-mm.
Okay. No. And is that the Bible that would be in the churches where these women are leaders?
Sure.
Okay. So if you have a pile of something you don't like, let's say it's, there's kids in the audience here, so I have to be careful. Let's say it's cars, old cars, old washing machines, etc., and they're piled up high, and the man climbs to the top, and the woman says, I can do that, I'll climb to the top. Isn't it important that it's still a pile of old cars? And isn't it important to look at what they're on the top of?
I'm following you. You talked a lot about
there are some brands of Christianity where a woman can be a leader.
Sure.
To me, the point is not that the woman's a leader. The point is, what is she a leader of? And she's a leader of a tradition that is antithetical to women, as we just discussed with Jeff.
No, she's not. That's one thing I think that I think you're seeing wrong, is that you look at history as if that is how we operate today. There's one way to interpret the Bible, that these are stories that happened a long time ago. What's it have to do with today? Today we have a different culture. They're saying, when Paul says a woman needs to be quiet in church, there's an interpretation that that was for them, that's not for us. So that has no bearing whatsoever.
Well, just as in the beginning there was Adam and Eve. I mean, if you're willing to say that's not important, that was just the time, then you almost have to acknowledge it's mythology. Stories.
Yeah, some Christians do. I mean, when I was a Christian, I accepted evolution, and so the Adam and Eve story is a myth. But what they say is it's a myth to teach you a godly principle, a theological principle, such as we're all sinners. It's not to teach you how humans were made, it's to teach you that we're sinners. So that's just an interpretation of it.
Okay. I don't have any other questions.
Okay, Ernie, it's your turn.
Okay, I guess just to carry on with what I was saying and what you were saying, is it seemed like your presentation was very heavy on history, and I think a lot of Christians don't know and maybe don't even care about the history. I mean, when you think about life, modern life, we got to live in this life. How do we live our life? And they might go to the Bible for some directions, and the Bible would say, women be quiet in church. Well, that's obviously something we don't need to listen to. And it says, husbands, love your wives. Okay, that's a good one. Let's do that. So I can see how Christians do that. So I kind of felt like a lot of your presentation was irrelevant because it was based on history and that's not modern times.
Well, I think I brought each of those into the present and to today, present. Tonight, there's a Republican debate of the presidential candidates. Every single one of those Republican candidates vows they believe in the God of the Bible, and they are against providing safe and legal abortions to women. Tell me how that's relevant today.
Okay, so that's an interesting thing there. So, that's an interesting question. Maybe the audience could help out later. If you look at abortion, there could be women who say, I believe abortion is murder, and any kind of abortion is murder, and I'm a feminist. I mean, they could say that. So that's a question. Can they be allowed to be feminists, even though they may disagree with most feminists? Maybe most feminists are saying there should be some kind of abortion allowable.
Think the issue here...
I mean, like, for example, Donald Trump. I mean, some people may say he hates women, but he would say, I love women, and, you know, even Carly Fiorina, whatever her last name is, Fiorina. I mean, they'll say, you know, she's got anti-woman policies and platforms, but she'll say, you know, she might say, hey, I'm for equal rights. I mean, after all, she led a company.
Well, the question we were debating today, does Christianity harm women? Are there nice Christians? Mm-hmm. And the point is that in the Republican presidential candidate debate tonight, every single one of those people, including the woman, relies on religion to say they believe that the government should prohibit safe and legal abortion for women. To me, that's taking us back to the Dark Ages. And I think it's really interesting, if you study the history of abortion, that whether it's medieval times or biblical times, there's always been abortion. And it really wasn't until the last 100 years where the issue of regulation of abortion came about, there was a real switch in the 19th century with churches.
But,
and the point is, there's going to be abortion. It's either going to be safe and legal, or it's going to kill women. And to use Christianity to justify a law that's going to end up with women being killed through unsafe abortions, to me alone, is a reason to say that Christianity harms women.
So how does was it my turn to ask or
it's yours?
Okay. So what's the, you said there's a problem with the new atheism movement. What is the problem specifically? I mean, on the Christianity side, we agree there is some problems. Like, for example, the Catholic Church. There's obviously anti-feminism there when a woman is not allowed the same access and leadership. A woman cannot be the Pope, for example. But I'm saying not all Christians or all Christian forms of it. So we talked about that, but what about the new atheism movement? You're saying there's a problem with feminism in the new atheism movement.
Well, I think the problem with the new atheism movement is it's mostly men talking about it. And that's why I decided to write a book. And I did, in the beginning, have guys. And then I decided to limit it exclusively to women, and I'm glad I did, because I think it's a good focus. And it gives a lot of different examples. There'll be about 20 essays of women and why they left religion. And I think that we all rely on models. I decided I was going to be a French teacher. My mother was a teacher. My sister was a teacher. Everyone in school were teachers. I never met a woman paleontologist or an archaeologist or doctor, superintendent or principal. We rely on models. I think if I had known scientists who were women, because I was very interested in science, I might have become a scientist. So in order for women to see it's okay to leave church, it's okay to say I'm an atheist, they need to see models of women doing that. And there aren't enough women who are saying, I'm an atheist, it's okay, I'm a moral person, I'm a humanist.
Well, why is that?
You too can be too.
Why is that? Why is that a problem?
I don't know. I don't really understand why women more than men cling to church. I gave the example of, you know, my mother-in-law, which was fine. She was fine going to church and taking the kids when her husband, who was probably an atheist, you know, stayed home. Is it the sense of community? Is it the sense of friendship?
Are you talking about church or the atheist?
I'm talking about why. Okay, in order to have more women atheists, you have to have women leave church, right? So what I'm saying is there's more women in churches who do a lot of the task and they're tied to it. And I think we need to analyze why that is. And I know for myself, I wouldn't have had any social life without church. You know, I mean, the church was Luther League. We went bowling. We went roller skating. We did all this stuff. If I wouldn't have been part of church, and we choir, rituals, all that kind of stuff. So we need, in order to get those women to leave church, we need to provide them examples of women who have left church. We need to take the position, I speak out. I'm a woman. I was like you. I was singing in the choir. I still am singing in choir.
So let me
leave it and speak up.
So let me ask you. So according to Christianity, there's anti-feminism baked in there, baked into the Bible. We both agree that there's anti-feminist Bible teaching.
We agree on that.
Is there anything like that in the new atheism movement? Is there anything in the atheism movement that is causing?
Well, I think anytime. Okay, there's a difference because atheists don't have a doctrine. They simply say, I do not believe in God. Whereas every type of religion has a set of doctrines. They usually have a holy book, whether it's the Quran, or the Book of Mormon, or the Bible. So they have a set of doctrines. So I don't think you can say there is an atheist doctrine that's against women. Now, it is, I believe, a social movement because it is a group of people who see an affinity. Now, they can't even agree on that because there's the secular humanists, there's the free thinkers, there's all these other kind of groups that have come together to provide that sense of community for people who are atheists. Now, anytime you get social people together, you're going to have a disagreement. There was, after these kerfuffles about elevator gate, etc., there was a group that wanted, they called themselves Atheism Plus. And they wanted, if you're going to speak and have a conference about atheism, you need to speak about feminism. You need to speak about intersexuality. You need to speak about race. You need to speak about this. Well, the atheists say we don't have that necessarily in common. That's not the focus. And that movement died out. I think some people just quit going to those conferences.
Actually, I think Atheism Plus is the same exact thing as secular humanism, and they didn't know secular humanism exists, and so they're trying to reinvent it. That's my opinion.
Yeah, and I wasn't really not involved in, so I don't know. It's only what I've read about it. But I think if we're going to provide support to women to leave church, we as women who have left church have to show how that's done and to be okay about it and to be models and to say, and I think it's important for every atheist to say, I'm an atheist.
So you don't see any problem right now in atheism that is causing it to, I mean, I'm still not clear. You're saying there's an anti-feminist problem within
atheism. No, I don't think there's an anti-feminist problem. I don't think there's enough women. That doesn't mean that the people who are involved aren't feminists. It means there aren't enough women there speaking out, and I think women, just as men do, they need role models.
Well, I mean, I think we could both agree there we need more women, but the question was, is there a problem for women in the new atheism movement? Like, is there a problem?
Well, I don't know why there aren't more women debating. Now, it may be a structured debate. You know, it may be that in tech speech and debating in college and they don't feel comfortable doing that. Maybe it's the structure of that. I don't know enough about it to say so. I felt very, very welcomed in the atheism community. And I will say, Richard Dawkins wrote a blurb for my book. And he said very nice things about, you know, it was great putting the book down to hear all of these different stories of women and how they left their fetters behind. So I've reached out to a number of well-known atheists, both men and women, to help me with my book, and I felt very receptive. But I also have had a history of taking jobs that were not traditionally held by women, etc. But I do think it's important. I think it's important to have, and I've said this 10 times, but to have models, to hear women's voices. And the more we speak out, the more important that's going to be.
Okay, just to summarize, we don't have it's hard to see a sharp contrast here on the atheism one. But on the Christian one, I think I see a sharp contrast where my point is, you know, maybe most Christian denominations have a problem with feminism, but there are definitely, it's not all Christians, and I don't see how you can say all Christians have a problem when specifically there is a church, at least one church, and this Foursquare church is like 69,000 churches worldwide or something. I mean, they have a lot. It's a big, and that's just one denomination. So, I mean, to me it seems perfectly reasonable to say there are some Christian denominations that have no problem whatsoever with feminism, if you define feminism as equal rights, because they can do everything and they don't hold back women in any way that I can tell. So I think that's where our disagreement is.
I think you could have a Christian church that was very progressive, that said, I support the Equal Rights Amendment, which, by the way, didn't pass in the 70s, that I believe there should be gender equality, etc. I think a group of people can say that. However, I think Christianity is a set of doctrines based on a book that is very harmful to women, and it's hard for me to visualize a woman standing up in a church talking about equal rights with the Bible in front of everybody in the pew, which has done nothing except over the last 3,000 years to denigrate and put down women.
I guess
so. If they get rid of the book, I'd be fine.
That's one thing that we clearly disagree on, is that you say specifically that Christianity is a set of doctrines, and my point is there is no such thing as a Christianity that is a set of doctrines. Every Christian denomination has different doctrines. I mean, there are general doctrines like Jesus died and rose again, but that has nothing to do with feminism as far as I can tell. So,
anyway. Let's have questions. That's the best part.
I will start with one question for Bernie, and then we'll open it up to the audience. The thing I'm wondering is, right now it's well documented that that atheists, at least identified online, are 75% male.
Mm-hmm.
And that's according to Atheist Census, which has counted like 500,000 people or something. And I believe Karen gave her explanation for that as there not being enough role models in the atheism movement. But I'm wondering what your explanation, or maybe at least an attempted explanation for that number is.
Okay, so number one, I haven't heard of this. But number two, I would ask you too, was it a scientific study? Because just because they have high numbers doesn't mean it's scientific. It could be still total garbage if they don't do it.
I don't think it's disputed often.
Okay.
Just because of the large sample size. But you could say that the internet maybe is.
Are you drawing from that 75% of the atheists are men, or are you saying that just that they're just the active ones?
They're the ones who filled out the internet survey. And you could say that there could be some sampling bias there because maybe men are more likely to look for this sort of thing on the internet. But that hasn't been claimed that often, I think.
So the question is 75%?
Let's assume that number is at least partially accurate, mm-hmm. and which I think that likely it is.
So you're saying saying that active atheists on the internet are 75% men?
People who identify as atheists, when you ask them,
mm-hmm.
they're 75% male. Or let's say that it's at least a significant majority.
Yeah. I don't know. I've never heard about that before. It's interesting. I guess it'd be interesting to look at.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes people come out with polls. Like there's this one poll that they said, most people who attend church are happier. And then there was like, okay, wow, oh my gosh, atheists, you know, they're not as happy as religious people. And then there's like, well, some other people did some studies and they go, well, it's not really so much a church, it's more of a community group. So like if an atheist is involved in a community group, that kind of counts and they're kind of happier than a regular person. So sometimes on the surface, results could be swayed. And like I said, just because I guess I would have trouble too, unless it was done by a person who really knows how to do a poll, because you have to know about statistics and you got to know a lot of things to have an accurate poll.
So your intuition here is to be skeptical of the number.
And it's also, I just don't know anything about the poll, like what was the exact question and what's the breakdown and all that. There's just so much I don't know about it. I can't like intellectually answer it.
We'll open it up to the audience now. I'll let the speakers.
Two questions for you, Bernie. First is, if feminism is equal rights for all, then what is humanism?
Okay, this is, by humanism, I assume you mean secular humanism? Because, I mean, there were a lot of different humanisms. There's also Christian humanism and everything, and there is a secular humanism, which kind of tried to take over everything. They tried to go by the name of humanism, too. But like Karen mentioned earlier, there's this group called Atheist Plus. And the idea is that atheists in general, a very small part of the population, I think according to religious polls, it may be like just 3% that say they're atheist. You know, not agnostic, not spiritual, but religious, atheists. Atheists are a very small number. So what happens is, a lot of times in debates, I'm giving a little background here. A lot of times in the debate, somebody will say, I'm an atheist. That means I don't believe in God. Well, what do you believe in? Well, I don't have to say what I believe in. I'm just an atheist. I don't believe in God. So then there's some of these atheists are saying, you know what? We should stand for something. What should we stand for? Well, maybe we should stand for equal rights. Maybe we should stand for democracy. Maybe we should stand for certain things. So that's why they try to start this group called Atheist Plus. It means we're atheists, but we also believe in these other things that we think are good to champion. It turns out that that's the same thing as secular humanism is. Secular, but the problem is most people don't know what secular humanism is because it's such a small group. But secular humanism is basically, how do you live this life in a naturalistic worldview? There's no God, so how should you live? And so there's a whole bunch of positive declarations. There's a council for secular humanism. So basically, secular humanism has been going on for since the 1900s. They've had a couple of manifestos, and they tried to do it. But because it's not very well known, I think the Atheist Plus people recreated it. So,
but how does that differ from your definition of feminism?
So feminism basically just means equal rights for women. Secular humanism would be how do you live your, basically it's a religion replacement. If you're not a Christian, what's your religion? And you might say, well, secular humanism is my worldview. Some of them don't want to be called a religion because they say religion is supernatural nonsense, you know. But so secular humanism is a worldview that would entail feminism. It would entail democracy. It would entail having morals without God. How do you have morals without God?
So feminism is a subset.
Yeah, subset of secular humanism, right?
And my second question is, how do you divorce what are, although not necessarily explicit, quite clear and often repeated points in the Bible that denigrate women? How do you separate that and still call the thing Christianity, since the only version of evidence we have towards what Christ was or what he wanted or what Christianity is in that book that requires those things?
Well, I guess the question is, you could go to the core of what is a Christian. And for a lot of people, like my final state as a Christian, the core is that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and he rose from the grave. And if you believe that, you will have eternal life. That's the core of Christianity.
But that's from the same place as all those other things. There's no other evidence of it but in the Bible, and the Bible says those things against women.
Well, yeah. I mean, for example, when it says, I do not permit a woman to teach, you should not have a woman teacher, you can just say, oh, that was it for their time. They didn't know we're going to be around 2,000 years later. So, you know.
Sure.
Oh, I would just like to add, and maybe this is a topic for another debate, but I think there's a lot of issues around the resurrection that could be examined. I was thinking on the way over here, okay, we've totally eliminated the feminine divine. There's no goddess. There's just the male. But God had a son. How did that happen? There's no mother in heaven. There's an earthly mother, supposedly, but there's no mother. It's another male-dominated image. It also is a further continuation of child sacrifice. It is interesting that if you look at the story of Isaac again and the sacrifice of Isaac, where is Sarah? She's not in the story. Mother's not consulted. The mother doesn't get to say, hell no, sacrifice me instead. It's all the guys. And I think by the time we got to the story of Isaac's sacrifice, there was a switch in child sacrifice, because it's clear that they sacrificed children to God. That happened. And that may have been a turning point when, no, do the goat instead, and they went to animal sacrifice. But to me, Christianity is based on child sacrifice, which is anathema. And I think it should be anathema to men and women. You couldn't figure out a better way to deal with the flawed creation you made than give a son to die? I know if somebody wanted to take my son, I would never give my son to be sacrificed. I would sacrifice myself. So the whole basis of Christianity to me is written by men.
Well, I think one counterpoint there is that it sounds like you're almost going off into thought police. So like these are feminist thoughts that you can have and you can't have. I mean, if feminism is all about equal rights, anything a guy can do, a woman can do, then it's irrelevant if you believe that, you know, God is a father or not, I think, because who's going to access the father, the prophet or the priest? And if it could be a woman, there's not a feminist issue there.
Well, the issue of why there isn't a feminine divine is tied up with power. And in order to get power, you don't want to share power. And this was what happened with Western civilization. And if you go back to hunter-gatherers, they were much more egalitarian. It was really when agriculture developed and property was owned that civilization started. Now, I'm really happy there's medicine. I was in a hospital at 10 months with pneumonia. I'd be dead 2,000 years ago. So we've made a lot of progress. But property and consolidation of power and affiliating religion with that and having a supreme deity who's a male was all tied up with power. So I think we have to look at why it, you know, as I said about history, we have to look at why it developed, what was the purpose of it. And to me, the legacy is so bad, it needs to be completely rejected. And it's like a pile of used cars. I don't want equal rights to be on a pile of used cars. Thank you. I would rather be on a pile of something good, not something bad.
I think one thing kind of funny about that too is one time I spoke to a Christian high school group and I mentioned, you know, did you notice how God is a father and it's not a mother? And their response was, well, you know, God is not really a gender. You know, you can think of it as a mother if you want to. But then the funny thing is, well, you can pray to God like, oh, you know, my Father in heaven, you know. But if a person were to pray, oh, Mother in heaven, boy, there's heresy there. I mean, it's like, oh, you can't say that. What are you doing? I mean, they would raise all kinds of eyebrows. So even though they say, well, obviously God's genderless, we just say our Father because it's just kind of vernacular. We don't really think of him as a male, but you can get away with calling him Father, but if you call him Mother, you know, that would never fly. So
got a question back here.
Karen. Do you know much about the phenomena of Amazonian women or any culture that's ever been women-based?
Well, I've read a great deal about the Mother Goddess, and I've read Joseph Campbell's work, Maria Gumbutas, etc., Gerda Lerner, Mary Daly, etc., and I've kind of come to the conclusion there have been societies where they were more matriarchal in nature, and certainly matrilineal, meaning they only knew the child was associated with the mother. They didn't know who the father was early on. The Iroquois, the Hopi, etc., have been more matriarchal. Was there ever a true matriarchy? Not in myth, but in reality, I don't know. But certainly the reason that there's this mother goddess image and it starts out with a mother goddess is because of nature. Is because look at the symbolism in a woman having your period every month and the cycle of the moon. You think about it and you don't know anything about the universe from scientific terms. That's pretty cool. I mean, wow, the moon goes around, you have your period, and the moon goes around 9 months and you have a baby. And there's a real veneration there. And when the goddess was worshipped, there was a real in tune with nature. It wasn't conquering nature. We were part of nature. And Lawrence Schlain has written a book, The Alphabet and the Goddess, saying that we didn't think of time as linear. We thought of time as cyclical. And that when writing came along, for some reason our brains shifted to think of time as linear and it's a beginning and an end. And that kind of thinking divorced us from the cycle. It divorced us from nature. And what have we done today? We've ruined our planet. Now, I'm not suggesting going back to worshiping the Mother Goddess, but I think we have lost some things in where we've come that we need to look at again.
I've got one follow-up question. There is inspiration or not for women. Women can be socio-psychodynamically
Yeah. I mean, can women be well? Can women be whole? Yeah.
Okay, well, to go through it again, there's a phrase in here, socio-psychodynamic. Are you understanding what I mean by that?
Unpack it for us.
Okay, it's kind of like inspiration. Inspiration. Can women be inspired or not?
Absolutely.
Where does that come from?
I mean, I think there are many instances today where women are the equal of men. And I know there's a lot about what is your basic nature, etc. I really think it's culture. It depends on how you grew up. You say women are nurturing. Well, it's because I played with dolls all the time. I couldn't play with my brother's erector set. I couldn't play with his chemistry set. I did have a little tool bench I got to play with, but you know, yeah, you learn to be nurturing because you're playing with your dolls all the time. I think most of that's taught by culture. It's not innate in our DNA. So I do think that there are a lot of situations where a woman can perform the same as a man, albeit some strength issues. They think the same. They are inspired by the same things. I think most of that is caught up in culture. It's not in our DNA. And I'm not sure that answered your question.
Mine was mostly commentary versus an actual question. Just was going to bounce off you guys with, I came from Christianity, went to paganism before I became an atheist. And I saw whenever I went to paganism, I found that there were some roots of paganism in Christianity. And once I went into paganism, I saw a lot of the mother goddess. There was going back to that. And I'm gonna say there's probably a lot more women who leave Christianity that go into paganism than they do atheism. And I think that's part of it. They had that spiritual need still when they leave Christianity, and they find that in the feminine to the divine by going into paganism and Wicca. So I took the long way around, and I know that there are other women who have done the same in atheism. I've seen them on Atheist Nexus and stuff.
Well, if I could just respond, yeah. I read a book called The Spiral Dance by Strawhawk.
Yeah.
Strawhawk.
Yeah, that one.
Starhawk.
Yes.
And it's interesting, there's a lot of civilizations that have the golden rule. The golden rule for the Wiccan is if you do bad, you get it back three times.
It goes for the good, too. It goes for the good,
yeah.
too. So.
Yeah, well, just one comment there, I think. I think there's a lot of people leaving religion. If you look at polls, it's just ramping up. And what happens is people are saying, because of the internet and everything, the word's getting out. It's like, these doctrines are silly, they're unscientific, you know, like they're anti-evolution, all this stuff. So a lot of people are saying, I'm going to dump the dogma and the religion. And so, yet they're saying, well, obviously God exists. I just know he exists, or she, or whatever. There's some kind of spiritual thing out there, right? So I could see, like, paganism when I was a kid, you couldn't find these people because there's no internet.
Right.
But now with the internet, there's groups like that.
Right.
There could be meditation and all kinds of groups. So,
oh, yeah.
So I could see the groups growing for that reason, because there's a lot of people seeking some kind of God without all the doctrine or the
right.
dogma, basically.
Right. I was going to further say that with respect to that, since there's a lot of women in Wicca and paganism, and they have that strength there, there's a sense of a safety net. And I think that might be what
mm-hmm.
we're missing in New Atheism, is that kind of safety net that women kind of want to have. And they have those in churches, too. And I was going to say, it almost... What we have here with New Atheism and a lack of voices from women reflects to me very similar kind of aspect that you have in the gaming community. There are, I was watching a documentary on gaming, and it said today, if you include, you know, cell phone games and everything, 47% of gamers are women. And yet, they're not in the gaming community as far as speakers. They're not in a lot of the programming aspects of it. And in this documentary itself, they only had one woman speaking and like nine other men speaking. So, you know, and that is a more fair ratio right there. So no wonder we don't have so many women speaking if they need that, a lot of majority need
yeah.
that safety net. Me, I didn't need that. I was gaming D&D in my early 20s, and I was one of the only women in my gaming group. I didn't care, but I'm an anomaly, so.
You know, one thing I'm thinking about is, you guys heard of Ronda Rousey, I think her
mm-hmm.
name is, in MMA, mixed martial arts.
Mm.
You know, she's very famous, and I saw her on an interview, and they were talking about, like, you know, you're not getting paid as much as a guy or whatever, and she was like, no, I feel... this is the most awesome sport. She says, I am the whatever she is, welterweight, featherweight, or whatever. She goes, I'm the champion, not the woman's champion,
mm-hmm.
the champion.
Right.
And it's like, I didn't realize that. Is that she's saying there's not a women's
awesome.
Thing here. So she's actually, you know, and then she got beat by another woman.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know all the details on that, but that was just interesting to hear her talk from that. So I'm just thinking in the Gamergate thing, if some woman, that maybe that'll change overnight, if some woman gets to be a really good player at something and gets
oh, yeah.
famous, you know, all of a sudden it could be like, oh, of course women play video games.
My mom owned Kaboom. I'm just going to say that. Sorry, it's an old game on the Atari 2600. She owned that game.
Question here.
Well, I think, my question is, one of the problems I hear is that, atheists don't have a real strong topic to revolve around, so it's hard to, people become maybe not drawn to it as much, or, we don't believe in anything, so, but I'm hearing, like the disparity with the gaming community, games are still really misogynistic and violent towards women, even though all these women play in secret, and in the atheist community too, my girlfriend never, I'll be watching an atheist speaker on TV and she'll be like, oh, look, another old white guy, it's just like, and a lot of women I was wondering what either you feel about having women, true equality be like a centerpiece for the atheist discussion in terms of,
Well, I called somebody out on Twitter because, the Four Horsemen is one thing, but it was three guys going to Australia, and it was Matt Dillahunty. And I just, how you do on Twitter, you have this knee-jerk reaction that you really should think about. But I said, and are there going to be any women you're taking with Matt? And he responded immediately, said, when I'm on a panel, there always are women on the panel. And this was something that got cooked up a long time ago, et cetera, et cetera. But he basically said, I really try hard to do that. And like I said, I think a lot of the men that I've, most of this is social media, I haven't met them personally, have been really welcoming. But, when you've got a profession, for example, I was director of the state bar. And, those first women who got into law were pioneers in the 20s and 30s and 40s. And we gave somebody their 50-year membership. A woman who must have gotten involved in the 30s, and I got to meet her, and I thought, you're one tough woman to be able to do it. And, in the 70s, when more and more women started to go to law school, they did form a group, women lawyers, and there's still a group, women lawyers, to provide what you said. How do you deal with a guy who says this? How do you deal with this? And now the majority of people in law schools are women. So, if you're going to be a pioneer and start out and make changes, it is harder.
Well, I guess one comment I have is I don't really see feminism as an issue in the new atheist movement at all. And one way I'm seeing this totally different than Karen probably and the way you phrased your question is foremost for me that, like I said earlier, the atheist community is so tiny as far as I'm concerned, like 3% or so. For example, I'm involved in this movement called Sunday Assembly. They're secular, basically it's like church without the God bits, they call it. So we're trying to develop a community without God-based superstitions and stuff. Okay, so they have all this press they're getting because this is a worldwide movement. We have over 100 groups now across the world, not just in the United States, but London or England and even France, Germany and France and all that. So 100 groups. Okay, well, I mentioned the Foursquare Church. They have 66,000 churches in 140 countries. That is just one denomination of Christianity. So, we are so tiny as a movement. It's like barely a blip. It's like, who are all the big guys who are the big people in atheism? Well, you can list five or six people, but if you knew anything about Christianity, you can probably list hundreds of people. So I think the bigger problem is we're just so tiny.
Wasn't the Sunday Assembly started by a woman?
By who? No. Well, a man and a woman. They're both comedians, Sanderson Jones and Pepe Evans. Yeah.
Well, and if I could just address this issue of community. When I belonged to, my husband and I went to Living Enrichment Center, which was all passed to God, et cetera. And when it went through its demise, that I'm proud to say had something to do with that, they were embezzling money. I never sought out a community. I said, okay, that's it. I can tell you that I read Bishop Spong's book on resurrection, myth, or reality, and that's the last piece that fell away for me. okay, didn't really rise from the dead, got it. And I never sought out anything. I decided I didn't believe in God. I would have called myself an atheist. But I was busy with work and family and book clubs and all of these other things. And it really wasn't until I decided to write this book last year that I started to go to these communities. And I don't see a need to go somewhere someday to be with people who don't believe in God. I mean, I will go somewhere Saturday or Sunday if it's an interesting topic I want to link to. So I think part of it is, why do you want to have a community at all with people who just don't believe in something? So there's fundamental issues there.
Well, that's why secular humanism or the Sunday Assembly, they're actually doing positive declarations. It's not that we're all getting together because we don't believe. We're getting together because we actually want to make this a better place and enjoy life and make friends and all that.
For both of you, would it be fair to say that when it comes to gaming or the atheist community, such as it is, that women simply don't like to cause, you know, stir up waves or cause controversy, and so therefore they're underrepresented in those areas which are more fraught with controversy?
Well, stirring up controversy has never been a problem for me, but I don't speak for myself, having caused enough problems. I don't know anything about gaming. But I do fundamentally believe that if you want to make a change about something, you have to do it. I want to give you an example. I was on strike against the University of Wisconsin as a teaching assistant. We were organized. We were a local of AFT. And the women TAs decided to have a meeting. And they all got together, and I was one of the two spokespeople for the press. I'd been president. I was very active. And one woman stood up and said, "We need to pick a woman to speak for us." And I said, "Excuse me." I said, "The guys aren't having a meeting and saying, oh, let's pick a guy to speak up at the next membership meeting. That's ridiculous. If you've got something to say, raise your hand at the next membership meeting and say it." And I was appalled that they wanted to choose one woman to speak at the next membership meeting. So, you know, part of it is learning, no, just speak for yourself. And I think as women do that, and they train their kids that way, and they teach their kids it's okay, you know, that's going to change over time. I think a lot of it has changed. And if there's a problem with the gaming community, then the women boycott the games, or they go create new ones.
There is kind of a cultural comment too, like what you're saying, is that like if a guy, you know, takes charge and does everything, he's a leader, but if a woman does it, she's bossy. You know, sometimes people say there's that, you know, bias in culture.
Some other B word.
Well, yeah. And I was the boss, so it didn't bother me called the boss.
I think the other B word. for women.
Any other questions?
Yeah, question.
I'd offer that there's like a great deal of framing in that question. Why aren't women comfortable, the onus being on them? It could be true that it's an incredibly toxic environment in gaming. I participated in different gaming stuff. And I've also seen the same thing being true in atheist circles. So a big problem I would offer isn't a lack of representation due to lack of effort, but instead of a structure that's insulated against bringing repercussions, or you know, if there's kind of gross actions going on, are they being like kind of covered up instead of dealt with?
Mm.
And so if that keeps going on, and if you look at the pattern of where there's like gross stuff going on, you see a structure, an institution that is able to be opaque. So if you look at the Catholic Church, that was your example. If you look at the military and other places, and I would argue that there's an air of intellectualism and atheism that provides that cover. That's the tying together glue that provides that kind of infrastructure. So just would like to point that out, that there's a great deal of framing when you, you know, if you go from top down as opposed to bottom up.
Yeah, kind of a little bit related to that. I can tell you, I have a YouTube channel, so I get a lot of people commenting on it, and I've noticed that atheists, you know, they could very easily let it rip. They, a lot of Christians normally they feel like you have to act like a Christian. Of course, when people have anonymous names, then they have the freedom to blow that off. But for the most part, Christians, you know, they probably at least feel guilty if they, you know, cuss or something. Whereas atheists like to let it rip, and some. So I have to ban people usually from my channel because I don't have time to maintain them. If they're just going to take a bunch of F words and just go right off, sometimes I ban people, and it's like, you know, 9-1 and mostly atheists. And so that might be what you're saying. If, you know, if atheists, are you kind of saying like if atheists and gamers have a nasty reputation, and maybe women don't like that, they're put off and they're going to leave? Is that what you're saying that?
A nasty reputation would be charitable. Mm-hmm. As being part of both areas firsthand for quite a while, I would make the argument that it's gross. And at first I didn't feel comfortable, and then I, you know, would speak up in certain mm-hmm. places. But it's a boys' culture, and I wouldn't go so far as to say that I wouldn't be an extreme example of criticizing it, because I actually still, you know, am involved with. But people deal with it in different ways, and you know what the easiest thing to do is just not speak your mind, and that's a bummer. And look at me, I'm like a white guy. Imagine if that my views were actually tied in with my physical person and what I identified with. It'd be even more terrifying, probably, to me, because I don't like speaking in the middle of the room.
Yeah, and I don't know about the statistics, but it was already mentioned that the gamers, like 47% were women. I don't know if it's true or not. So that's different than what you're saying, like 75% guys were atheists on the internet. So there's a little difference there. I don't know if the numbers are true or not.
Yeah, I just want to go back on the gaming it's not the subject, but and it's also just a personal experience, but as a women gamer, you have a lot of benefits of being a woman in the game. You're treated differently. Yes, it's misogynistic, but at the same time, it's at the benefit as a woman. You're, depending on what game you're playing, and what's it interesting to me in the gaming community is that women tend to be very protective of those benefits and tend to be a little, they don't bind together, get together, to make a safer community for women, but they tend to protect their own territory as the only women in a guild or something like that, because they reap out the benefits of being this unique, this being
unicorn.
Yeah, kinda. So it's not necessarily the men's problem. I think it comes from the women who are catty, I want to say. And try to cultivate this uniqueness and being. It comes from us. It's not just one side, I think.
Candy or some other C word.
is that kind of similar to a woman who says, "No, I can take care of myself, but why don't you open the door for me?" Or I like it when guys open the door for me, but treat me as an equal, or
yes,
or
pay for
the date, but I'm equal, or
but
something.
I mean,
like.
A lot of independent and strong women will want to take advantage of the misogynistic word and make it work for themselves. You know, like you can use it at your advantage, and it's being misogynistic in some way. Also, like taking advantage of the men's world.
Ultimately, that's the survival mechanism of being in a male-dominated, fear-based, repercussion-based culture that's been, you know, propagated by Christianity in general.
The
it's
idea
like survival.
The idea that there's a power imbalance is pretty blatantly false. It's just that women like to not make waves and have the power behind the scenes. So every time you see a guy in power, you can bet your butt there's a woman telling him what to do at home. That's the way the world has always worked.
The argument against that that I'm aware of is
that's Donald Trump's secret. He's got a strong woman at home.
I don't think he has a secret.
Wonder if she tells him you're fired.
I think a good argument against that is that, like, access to just equal opportunity within a realm like in a gaming community or within atheism is actually like a precious thing. And when you're part of the minority that's you know, scrapping for the things being, you know, granted to them or prescribed, I would argue that in gaming, like, oh, you're a woman, like gaming, you're cool with us, right? You're not like one of those, you're not here to, you know, disrupt everything. As long as you go along with that, kind of like fulfill the role like you're a chill girl, then you're granted this privilege of being part of that community, which of course everybody, if you love the game or if you love the movement that you're part of, you want to be accepted. Well, if it's overrun or disproportionately represented or represented by one type of demographic, there's going to be a lot of pressure to conform to whatever, you know, their pre-existing like expectations are. And so if you imagine yourself as a minority in any type of situation and you're enjoying a lot of privilege because you've kind of like you're fitting a thing, then somebody else shows up, it's reasonable to expect that there would be conflict there. So that's what I'm aware of. And there is some, in psychology, there's some research behind it, but it's a preliminary thing, and the people behind it actually wrote books that sold really well, but their research was a little lacking, so. I'm a psych student, so I'm like too aware of like all the infighting and everything. But
what do you think it means that the gaming community and the atheist community are relatively new on the scene? Because only since the internet have they become a force to be reckoned with.
That's hard. I mean, like, things that got brought up earlier tonight about, like, what's the fundamental underlying reason why this is happening? Well, if anybody here knew that, you know, we'd be probably not here. Or up front, you know. So those are hard questions. There are some analogies between the two, but they're not going to be perfectly analogous. As far as, like, the... I guess it would be the online communities. Gaming communities are gonna just inherently lend themselves to having online communities, and I guess just because of the time frame of the new atheist movement and forums, I guess, and YouTube, rambling YouTube videos,
podcasts.
comment sections. Maybe that's the only similarity as far as the conversation goes, but yeah, the people that are joining them, that's a hard argument. So, yeah, I wouldn't have an answer.
I just want, as one of the participants, want to say thank you. I appreciate you coming this evening, and thank you for your questions.